Father, I thank you for this evening, for this retreat, for this time with you, for our quiet time today, for all that you have yet to do in our hearts. We have so much more, Lord, and we thank you. We anticipate. We are expectant of your hand and your loving touch tonight. Be with our worship ladies. Strengthen them. Strengthen their hands, their fingers, their vocal cords, as we, Lord, are led into your throne room. And Father, Vicky, strengthen her body, and may she minister, Lord, and if there's something not in her notes, may you just speak to her. And Father, I just thank you for this whole night and for these women here in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hi, ladies, why don't we all stand up?
Praise God. Isn't that a great song?
Yes.
You know how there are worship songs that you will always relate with some event in your life, like you just remember something? I just leaned over to Emily and said, this song will always remind me of someone very special in Russia. If you follow Far Reaching newsletters, you've heard of Lydia, Grandma Lydia. And she was a very, very precious woman of Jesus who is now waiting for us in heaven. But we met her, I don't know, maybe 7 or 8 years ago, and God felt very strongly that Wes felt very strongly that God had said we were to reach out to her and show her love. She was from one of the Calvary Chapels in a little city called Redeemer. And she had a large birthmark on her face. And because of that, she never married. The Russians are very, they have a very hard time with disabilities or anything out of the ordinary. But she just loved Jesus so much. And just before she went home to be with the Lord, we went to visit her at Christmas time, as you probably heard Wes share. And I remember all of us were seated around the table, and one of our missionaries who used to serve in Africa but's now gone back home to Russia, Natasha, she's a wonderful worship leader, and she and another lady who leads worship named Lena were singing, and they would sing some Russian Christmas hymns and carols, and then some in English, or if it was a song we all knew, we would sing in English, our team, and they would sing in Russian, and it was just a little taste of heaven. You know how you have those moments? And I remember they sang that song, This Is Our God. It happened to be Lena's favorite at the time. And so they were singing it in Russian, and we were singing it in English, and the lights were down, the Christmas tree lights were there, and I remember just looking at, we called her Babalita, and she just had tears streaming down her face, but the biggest smile. And it was like the Lord just gave her a glimpse of heaven, and honestly, it was maybe 2 weeks before she had her stroke. And I think we all knew that Christmas when we said goodbye that we wouldn't see her again until glory. So I love things like that, and I love being able to share them, because for Christians, we don't ever have to say goodbye, which is so awesome. So would you please pray with me one more time as we go before the Lord? Oh, Lord God, thank you so much that you are our servant and our King, and that, God, you've rescued not only the world, you've rescued us. And, Lord, I just want to lift up before you right now those people in our lives that we love, that don't yet know you, that have rejected the message of grace and hope, Lord, or ones that have strayed from you, Father God. I just pray, Lord, that tonight you would help us to partake more fully than we have ever before in our Christian life of who you are, of your divine nature, and that, God, we would at that moment catch a glimpse of what's waiting for us. And God, you would use it to literally set us on fire. Jesus, fire, Raven Hill used to say, it's the most attractive thing in the world. We don't have to tell anyone about it. They're fascinated with it. And I pray that your love would burn like a fire in us, God, and that it would just draw, you say you draw people to you with your love. And I pray for those family members that we've wept over, God, that we've just begged you for, and it's especially those ones that have been hurt, maybe by someone in the church, or people like my mom, God, who are just deceived by cults, and they're just going straight to hell, God, because they believed a lie. And Father, I just pray that that fire would be infectious in us, and that, Lord, you would use us to fill up heaven. I pray that each woman in this room would take every life that touches hers with her to heaven. God, I just pray that you would do something that truly is supernatural, that when we come together next year for this women's retreat, I just pray wherever I am in the world, I can be back here and hear the testimonies of my sisters of what you've done. God, and just sit in and listen and know, Lord, thank you. Thank you that you're such a great and awesome God, that you're so mighty, and that you love the lost so much. I do, Lord, just pray for our families who are behind at home, or I don't know what they're doing to fill their time while we're away, but Lord, I pray you bless them. I pray that you would just especially, God, as we go back tomorrow, and who knows what the enemy is going to try to do to make us trip, I just pray you'd be thwarted right now in the name of Jesus, God, that no sickness would fall on the children or any of us, that God, as our sister Julia fell, no one else would be harmed, Lord. And I pray you'd so turn this situation around for Julia, God, that we would rejoice even in a fall, something that seems so tragic, God, it would turn into a huge blessing, God. And I just pray, Jesus, that we would have such love to shower on our families, Lord, that they would send us away willingly when we say we're going to a retreat. Lord God, that we would bring them back a blessing similar to the one you've touched our hearts with, Lord. I pray, Father, that you would make this word alive in us. You know our finite minds, God. Help us to be alert. Help us to just hear you. And again, I just want to ask that you would look straight into our eyes, Lord, and that we would have that tunnel vision, be in the zone, be so focused on you, that we would be able to grasp with everything in our hearts this amazing truth. God, thank you. I just feel like that's the most empty word sometimes, because it doesn't express my heart, but I'm so glad that you can read my heart, Lord, and you can read each of my sisters' hearts. Please, Jesus, receive our worship, receive our whole being tonight, and just have your way in us, we pray, in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, I have to tell you in advance that I might talk too fast again. I really try not to, but I get so excited about this topic. As you can see, I get a little excited about anything that has to do with Jesus. But I do have that tendency to talk fast, so I'm sorry for that. But I wanted to start out by just giving you a little review, because Emily lovingly told me that maybe I was going through some of the scriptures too fast. So let me just, before we begin, recap what we've talked about so far. And I just want to make sure that I thank you so much, because I felt your love and your prayers and your acceptance. It's very rare that so many people in the audience are engaged and make eye contact, and that's just been a great blessing. I feel like, even though I've not gotten to sit down and talk to each one of you, I feel like I've connected with you a little bit, and that's really special. So I want to thank you for that. And I just pray that you would find in the remainder of this retreat, especially in tonight, more of what you've been looking for in Jesus. So as you faithfully prayed for me, I want you to know that Emily and I, we've been really praying for you. And I know your team that organized all these beautiful things is praying for you as well. I feel like I've enjoyed myself in a whole new way with you guys. I can't explain it. And Emily will tell you, I've never said that before. So it's really the truth. As I told you that Jesus can be seen in a soul that's wholly given over to them. You know, his joy is so infectious. Someone said the other day that verse in Zephaniah, I think you read it, didn't you, Amy? 3:17, and if any of you ever listened to Pastor Chuck or watched him, he was kind of, I mean, he had a sense of humor and he was warm, but every now and then he would just say something that you'd think, wow, that surprised me that Pastor Chuck said that. And it was like he was in a moment of when he was about to tell a story about one of his grandkids, you know? He got this big smile on his face, and I remember I was sitting on the floor just waiting for the word, and it was my first time through the Bible with him. And so we were in the book of Zephaniah, and he shared that verse from 3:17 about how God's rejoicing over us and singing over us, how he delights in us, and I was just like, wow, you know, all of my new excitement at being a Christian. And he goes, I want you all to understand. And his eyes started to twinkle and he said, this is that kind of joy that just jumps up and down and twists around. And I was like, yes, I knew that was biblical. You know? Have you guys ever felt like that? There's just so much joy in your heart. It's like you just want to jump up like they do on commercials and you never could in real life, you know? So I just feel like we are blessed because that's the kind of joy that God has in us, and that's the kind of joy that he wants to give us tonight that we can show to other people. The kind that maybe you're not a jump up and down expressive person, and that's fine too, but it'll still spill out of you. It'll find its way that's right for your personality. We're all supposed to be different as we are. And I really do pray that as you go home, this all sticks with you. So we've been talking about rest for the weary. And as I said, I'm sure this is not what you expected in terms of rest, as we've talked a lot about that perpetual rest instead of just laying down in a physical rest. But as I said to you, only two out of the 2.5 to 5 million, however many people there were that came out of Egypt, actually made it into the promised land, actually took that first step into rest that was the precursor for that perpetual rest. So we're not alone if we've never experienced God's perpetual rest in our Christian life. But we can overcome, and I hope that's what we're going to do. Unbelief, as we saw, was the root cause of what happened. They started to doubt, they gave way to fear, and of course that ended up in unbelief. Tragically, unbelief is something that still slows us down, and we talked about the pitfalls of that. As we closed last night, we went all the way up to the throne of grace, and we, in our own ways, poured our heart out. And I don't know what you said before the Lord, but I feel like no one would have stayed as long as they did if they weren't doing something personal with Jesus. And I want that to stay as personal as you want it to. Whether you choose to share is totally up to you. But what happened was, as we emptied ourselves, we made room. And then Jesus has been free all day today. As you had your quiet time, as you went through directed prayer, as you fellowshiped with friends, I hope that you've just been adding. I heard a pastor say years ago, and it's really true, when we empty our hearts of sin or a burden or a fear or something that's kind of quenching the Spirit from flowing in our life, we need to let the Lord put a rock in its place. And you know, Christ is the rock, right? Give us a promise, put it in the word. I mean, put it in our hearts to fill that empty spot. But then I like to think of the Holy Spirit as the cement that makes sure that rock never moves. It's not taken out. Because you know, the Holy Spirit promised, I'll call to remembrance everything Jesus taught. I'll help you, you won't forget. So in a way, he is like the cement, you know, that makes it permanent. So I pray that tonight, as we just do this quick review and then move on, you guys will have it cemented inside. That I'm really hoping, I wish we had time for everyone in here to share the promises God showed you in your quiet time. Because those are the things you don't want to lose sight of. Leonard Ravenhill used to say, if he could just pull back the curtain of eternity just for a second, we would sin less, we'd be depressed no more, we'd just be so taken up with the glimpse of what we saw. Paul said, I can't even speak about it, it was so incredible. And I'm so tempted to pridefulness, this thorn has been allowed to come to me, so I don't just spend my days daydreaming, I keep going and remembering I have a job to do to bring people there, you know? I mean, of course he didn't say it that way, I'm making it a little bit casual, so, but you understand what I'm saying. We are going to see, hopefully, tonight, that as we continue with this hunger and thirst that we brought before the throne of grace last night, God will never be exhausted of filling us more, of giving us more revelation and understanding. And then this morning we talked about purposing in our hearts to follow Jesus, and how the Word of God is alive, and it is in fact Jesus himself, and the power of communing with the Lord and strengthening that personal relationship. We saw that Jesus is our forerunner. He went through the veil into that holy place, and that's where he's leading us. And we talked about the fact that as disciples, we chose to go closer to Jesus. But now in this place of eternal rest, of perpetual rest, which I hope to show you tonight, is really just abiding. It's just letting him dwell in us, be at home in us. The Word already says that we're the temple of the Holy Spirit, but have all of us so that we can live and move and have our being in him and everyone can see it. Amen? Our kids, our neighbors, everyone. Anyway, so as we followed him in discipleship, we saw that the only way for that relationship to grow was through the Word, through the Logos, the whole counsel of God. And then through the Rhema, the spoken, or not just the spoken, it's the specific utterance that came for our situation. And remember, I gave you the example of Jesus wept versus a scripture against, you know, a scripture of purity and waiting for the person God chose you instead of Jesus wept, if your temptation is another relationship when you're waiting on the Lord. We talked about how that the steps for us to stay that close to Jesus are just that simple, utter dependence. We talked about John chapter 15, verses 5 to 8, about how we can do nothing apart from the Lord. And boy, I don't know about you, but I need to be reminded of that every day. Not because I'm trying to do it on my own, because I beat myself up when I fall. And so I have to remind myself, oh, okay, I was trying to do that on myself. It's by myself. It's okay. I'm going to be okay this time because I'm going to wait on God. So it's my encouragement, not my condemnation. We talked about how our strength is always going to be too little. Our righteousness is always going to fall short. But he has enough for us and for everyone else. And so now we're going to be talking about being a partaker. And so I'm going to leave the little steps that I had marked down to go through how we're going to talk about that, because I realized that I forgot to tell you something this morning that I do want to touch on today. And I want to ask you to set aside somewhere between 1 month and 3 months of just purposing in your heart during your quiet time, or if you are able to squeeze in an extra, you know, 10 minutes or 15 minutes or however much time you can give each day, I want to challenge you to spend that time purposing to really dig into a certain portion of scripture. So if you do have your pens, please write this down. In the book of Romans, as you know, if you've studied church history at all, it is such an important book, and it's been something that throughout the centuries God has used in revivals and to bring people from the place of religion to relationship. It's a very amazing section of scripture. But in Romans chapter 5, 6, 7, and 8 is that portion of scripture that's so foundational for what has happened in us as believers. And so in chapter 5, most of you know this already, is where we learn what it means to be justified. It's about our justification. 6 and 7 are about our sanctification, which we talked about this morning a little bit, and we're going to talk some more about tonight. And then 8 is about the victory, about our glorification, about what's coming, and about the amazing things that God is doing in us, the love he has and how it can never be taken. So many wonderful things. But the reason I'm saying this is because I meet Christians every day, and I'm sure Cindy would agree with me, and I'm sure you do as well, that really don't understand the depth of what Jesus has done for them. And so when you start to talk to them about being one of the 2 out of 5 million, it's already way over their head. I mean, that's over my head just saying being 2 out of 5 million, right? But when you talk about someone who really doesn't know, and as a new believer, I told you I came from a religious background, so when I studied this passage of scripture, I was just amazed at every single verse. And what I want you to do is just ask God personally to show you how he's broken the dominion of sin in your life. What does that mean? Ask him what it means when it talks in Romans chapter 8 about how we can live in the spirit and no longer ever fulfill the lust of the flesh. Lord, what? How? Where? And he's going to start showing you through that rhema, through the spirit prompting you, through the giftings. He's going to start showing you things that will, number one, encourage you like you can't even believe. But I promise you this as well, it will crack wide open so much of the rest of the scriptures. Is there anyone else that can attest to that fact and who studied that a little bit? It's so powerful. So just, like I said, it doesn't have to be a long time, but just purpose. Say, God, I want to understand what's really happened to me. I want to know when people are talking and fellowshipping about this intimacy with you. Because I think like you're God, and you know, I don't know. I don't want to put words in your mouth or waste my time trying to describe what could be so different in each of us. But I do want you to know that this is one of the most worthwhile studies in scripture that you will ever do. And it will help you have that abundant entrance into heaven. It can't do anything but strengthen you and take you deeper in your closeness to God, okay? So I forgot to tell you that this morning. So that's just my personal request, that you set aside some time this year to do that. Not 2016, but like within the next 12 months, you know. And what would be really cool if your spouse is saved is maybe that's something you guys could do together. And I don't encourage you at this point to get a commentary. Just let the Bible be your commentary, you know. Use the little references in the middle and grab out a dictionary, or, you know, talk to Cindy and Pastor Phil and just find out some different ways that you can just study with what you have at home. Amen? And then once you've done that a little, then go ahead and listen to some other messages and just start to glean from what other people have studied. Okay, so tonight we're going to talk about being divine partakers. Partakers of the divine nature. I don't know why I'm tripping over my words, so please pray. It's some kind of crazy word here. But I wanted to tell you that Emily and I had the privilege this summer in June of going down to Miami Beach, Calvary Chapel, Miami Beach, and sharing at a women's conference. And the year before, we had talked similar to what we're talking about now, really about the difference between relationship and religion, and just, I would say, as most of what we've said so far, it's foundational stuff, but it's things we do need to be reminded of. And so when they called me, they said, we really want you to come back because we've been praying about it, and we feel like we just want to continue on from what we studied last year. And here's me, you know, post-menopausal, thinking, I don't remember what I said 5 minutes ago. I'm not sure I can remember what I said 12 months ago. If anyone can relate. So we were scrambling to find the tapes and, you know, no, I'm just kidding. But it was so neat because the pastor's wife, Elizabeth Fountain, she's from Denmark. And so she said, I chose as the title, Deeper, Wider, Higher, More, from Ephesians 3, 19 and 20. And I'm like, okay, that's pretty broad, you know? And as I thought of that, I thought that's how I feel right now, trying to jump into the divine nature of God and how we can tap into that and have all that He has and know the things that He knows and do greater miracles than what He did while He was here. And I thought about how this is where I wanted to start. I would like you to look in your Bible with me just a minute in John 17. Because I think it's always best when we can hear Jesus' words Himself. And actually, that's what I pray that you'll hear instead of my crazy voice, that you will hear Jesus' voice, because it's so rich and full each time. But I want you to look specifically towards the end of the chapter, underneath, if you have subheadings, where it says Jesus prays for the believers, from verse 20. And I'd like you to tonight, before you go to bed, just go through this section and read it and circle where it talks about one, O-N-E, one, and then where it's where Jesus says, I don't know how you can circle this, so let me not give that idea, but I want you to just take note of what you, actually this is a good thing, maybe make a little list on your notebook that you're using for the conference of the things that He specifically asks God would bless you with. Because I think you're going to be astounded and blessed how selfless Jesus is. You're going to see that He's praying for you to be one with God the Father the same way He is one with God the Father. And if you start thinking about that, you'll get overwhelmed, because I always do, and I've been thinking about it for a while. But, you know, he talks about how He wants us to enjoy this very partaking of the nature of God that we're going to be talking about tonight. So when I'm saying that this is possible, I want you to see for yourself tonight that this is what Jesus prayed and is praying for us. He really desires for us to know the goodness of God. He doesn't want it to be head knowledge. He wants it to be heart knowledge. And I know that if you're involved in ministry of any kind, ministering to your children, leading a Bible study at your work, serving in children's ministry, a small group leader of some kind, no matter what ministry, isn't that your heart for the people that are partaking? Every week you're praying for them to grow in grace. And we find ourselves just, when we come to some place that we feel like they may not understand, we're just laboring in prayer. We start to understand what Paul meant when he said, I travail, like I'm going to give birth. It's just so important to me that this gets implanted in your heart and no one takes it from you. And I want you to see your king, your groom, your Savior is praying that for you. He's just thrilled that you're sitting here tonight and you have that desire to know. I don't know, that almost brings me to tears every time I think about it, especially when you put in context when this is happening. I'm not going to tell you, just look at it and see. Realize as you're reading through it tonight how much pressure is on Jesus. And yet at that moment, His only thought is on you. And it's just such a beautiful picture. So I want you to know this is God's heart for you. Keep your Bible open, because we are going to look at another passage in just a few minutes. But I'm really going to try to stay to my notes. So He wants us not only to imitate Him in our love for others and our love for God, but He wants us to imitate Him so truly and so deeply in heart that our prayers, our time that no one else sees, is also like that time in His life. So often we read Jesus went away somewhere to pray in the night quietly. We don't know what He did. So you're like, God, how do I imitate? Well, this is the best we're going to get. We need to seek. We need to dig. We need to trust the Holy Spirit is going to lead us to learn from these passages what He did when he was praying. And take the prayers that we do see and have more information about how he prayed, and then adjust that and imitate, not in a robotic kind of way, but you understand what I mean. Follow his example. I want us now to look at a series of just a few verses. First, we're going to look at Hebrews 2, chapter 11, which I believe I spoke to you today. And these are all, again, just confirmations about this concept of partaking. So verse 11 of chapter 2 in Hebrews says, "Both he who sanctifies, which is Jesus, and those who are being sanctified, which is us, are all of one. For which reason he, being Jesus, is not ashamed to call them, being us, brethren." So it tells us right there that Jesus is the one sanctifying us, that we are coming together. He's not ashamed that we're one. Do you see how it says they are all of one? And as I told you earlier today, positionally, that's already done. You're already adopted legally. You are already joint heirs with Jesus. He's going to tell us now, and through this issue of partaking, that not only is it already done legally, he wants us to enjoy the benefits before we get to heaven. Now keep your finger right there. You probably don't even have to turn the page. And look over at verse 14, please, of the same chapter 2. "Inasmuch as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. For indeed he does not give help to angels, but he does give help to the seed of Abraham." And again, that's pretty straightforward. I don't think I need to explain to you really what that means. The first verse told us the one who's doing the sanctifying is Jesus. That's the divine God side of what Jesus is doing. This verse right here is saying he partook of flesh. That's the human side. Okay? So both of these are telling us what Jesus has partaken of to step into this role, that we might have this oneness and intimacy together. God said through the writer of Hebrews, and I'm just going to summarize this part, but you'll see it as you read through the book, that Jesus was perfected through the things that he suffered, that he learned obedience to God through the things he suffered. And sometimes I would read that and think, I don't understand that. If he's God and he knows everything, what exactly does that mean? And what I'm learning, and I'm still learning, and would love to hear if you have any thoughts on it after Bible study, is that he was learning as a man. He was learning what it felt like to go through temptation and to experience and feel what we feel. He was coming to our level the same way we do, maturing and growing and facing those temptations, so that when we came to him with a need, he would be ready. Does that make sense? That helps me understand. And the reason I say that is because he took every measure that he possibly could to fully partake of us in his body, in the way he felt things, like in his emotions, his feeling side, in his mind, in how he related interpersonally with others, because he lived here 33 years. He felt being born and having siblings and the things that we feel. And the reason I'm bringing that up to us is because when we enter a topic like this, partaking of God's divine nature, that's a little bit weird. It might have required some effort on my part that other people might not understand. That may seem at the end of my first day kind of like, well, why did I study that for the last 2 hours? Or it might be difficult to understand. We might close the Bible and think, I've been way over my head, or this seems so simple. Why? You know what I'm saying? Like, it's going to require effort on our part too. But he went first. He initiated, as he always does. His love always goes first. His love always initiates. And I guess my encouragement is, he did that because that fellowship and that intimacy with you is so important. And I don't know why. I wish there was some clue in the Word of God that I could point you to. But even though we're going to be with him forever and we're going to fellowship with him forever when we have a glorified body, there's something really special that can be a part of that intimacy if we'll have it now. Or he wouldn't be encouraging us to go there. It's like, you know how they say when you really dig for gold is when you find the good stuff, the big diamonds or the, you know, payload or whatever. Somehow there's a payload in this partaking of him while we're still in this flesh. I don't know. I wish, ladies, I could tell you. But I know that he doesn't lie. And I know that if he's telling us this is worth our while, then it is. Okay? So, he was in every way prepared to do whatever it took. Now I want you to look with me just for a second. You can just stay in the book of Hebrews and look over at verse 3 of chapter 14. And that verse says, we have become partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the end. We, you and me, this is our side. Now he's switching from Jesus, and he's saying, if you want to be a partaker of Christ, and this is why I'm saying, he's telling us there's something important about this time while we're still in the flesh. Because did you notice he said, if we hold fast from the beginning until the end. So for some reason, we're going to discover, and that's why I think it would be so neat to see where we all are in a year. And to see where God's taken us, and to encourage and sharpen each other's faith by hearing the testimonies of, this is what Jesus has shown me. This is what I've learned about partaking. This is the miracle that I got to see happen. You know, it's real. It's not a dream. And I hope that during this journey for you, I know Cindy loves you guys so much. She'll be encouraging you, but encourage each other. Don't forget. You'll see over and over in the scripture, but particularly in Hebrews, you're going to see that constant reminder of, wake up, stir yourself, don't forget, don't be slothful, be vigilant, hold on tight. There's just, I wish I knew who the writer was and could understand how he had such a good grasp of how easy it is for us to be like, oh, you know, ADD, or you know what I mean? A butterfly, and we're lost on another tangent. Don't do that. Encourage each other to stay the line and keep going for the gold, because it's going to be worth it. And then lastly, I just turn a few more books over, and we're going to look at 2 Peter, chapter 1. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. Actually, I'm going to start at verse 2. It's very short. Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus Christ our Lord. As Jesus' divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness, through the knowledge of Jesus, who called us by glory and virtue, by which have been given to you and to me exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these promises you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. This is one of my life verses. It's one of those verses that just thrills me to the bone, as you can tell, and are probably tired of hearing by the end of the weekend. But every word of it's so rich. And I just want you to see that that's now 4 verses about that relationship and that closeness. And I haven't even looked hard or far. But I want you to see it now. Be aware as you're in your quiet time. as you are just seeking God in whatever way you normally do right now, be asking Him, show me when there's something in the Word about this partaking of your nature. Show me when there's something more about abiding. I want to learn more about this perpetual rest. And I guarantee you're going to find one. I want to read for you a quote from this book that I told you about, the Holiest of All by Andrew Murray, which is, as I told you, it's just about Hebrews. And I'm just going to show you, mine's a little marked up right now because I'm using it. But the chapters are very short. This particular chapter ends right here. It's only 2 pages long. At the end of each chapter, there's a small section of questions just to get you thinking and meditating on what you just read. So I can't encourage you enough, if you have time, in addition to your Bible reading, always make the Bible first, but if you have time, you would really enjoy this book because you can go as slow as you want or as fast as you want. And it's great to use with the family. If you have older kids, they might really enjoy it as well. Okay, so our quote is right here on page 147 from chapter 27, and it says this: in partaking with us of flesh and blood, Christ entered into perfect fellowship with us in all that we were. Our life and our death became Christ. When we became partakers of Christ, we enter into perfect fellowship with Him and all that He was and all that He is. His death and His life become ours. It works both ways. And that's what's hard for us to wrap our head around, or at least me. Maybe you have no problem. But to me, I feel like over the years of walking with the Lord, I got saved on December 31st in 1989. So I've been saved a long time. But I feel like when I listen to verses like that one we just read about partaking of the divine nature, or Galatians 2:20, I don't think I really know what that means. I don't know if I really feel that Christ is alive in me. Some days I do. You know, when I had my devotions and my checklist looks good and I'm comfortable with grace and not condemning myself at all. But I want to know it in the deepest part of my heart, just like I know I'm saved. Does that make sense? And I feel like it's there that we're going to find the little treasures that we don't have as we're still searching. Okay. Then we go on and he says, just a few pages down further in this book, he says, we can have no further entrance into God's favor or good pleasure than to the extent that the Father sees Jesus in us. And all of us have learned that pretty much since Sunday school, right? They teach us, you know, it's like without Jesus, you don't get in to see the Father. And we have so many, you know, scriptures to back that up. But I was wondering what a difference, too, it would make if people saw Jesus in us. If that would give us a better audience with them. You know, we read in the book of Acts how they would start preaching and people would say, hey, these guys are fishermen. Where'd they learn to preach like that? And then they'd listen and realize, oh, these guys have been sitting down with Jesus. And they would listen more. I wonder, Christians, sisters, what the Muslim world would do. You know, if Jesus was really shining in us. I know they don't know Him, but there would be something that would show them that it's divine and it's not us. That love in us is genuine. I wonder what Hillary Clinton would say. You know, after she said about us being deplorable and homophobic, what if she really saw us? I mean, really saw us loving people the way Jesus did. And aside from everything else we've talked about that weekend, don't you feel like there would be just showers and buckets of blessing that came in your life for knowing that? There's no way we can lose in this pursuit of partaking of the divine nature. Okay, we are already clothed in His righteousness. And I want you to write down John chapter 3, verse 30. This is another one of my favorites, where John said, I have to decrease so that Jesus can increase in me. And that's what we're going to see about partaking. We know that God and sin can't have anything to do with each other. So the byproduct, if you will, of holiness, I mean, of partaking of the divine nature is holiness. Because God has to get our sin out of the way in order to fill us and do what he wants to do in us. Which just makes sense when we think about it. Okay, I have another quote for you right here. And it goes like this. Believer, would you like to enjoy the full assurance and the full experience that you are a partaker of Christ? Yes or no? Christ is a living person, and he can be known and enjoyed only in a living personal communion. Christ is my leader, and I have to cling to him. I must follow him in his leading. He's my high priest. I have to let him lift me into God's presence. You know, I won't get there on my own. Then he says, Christ is the living Son of God, who is our life. I must live in him. But at the same time, I'm his house. And I can only know him as his son in his house as I yield myself to his indwelling. I just think these quotes are so rich. You can just chew on that for a little while. How do I become actively partaking as we're being exhorted to right here? I just wrote down a few things that came to my heart as I really meditated on it. I want you to add to this list, but here's what I've got. We have to come out from ourselves so that, forsaking all of the sin and all we are, so that we can go in to Jesus. Just as we saw this morning in Deuteronomy 6:23, we have to come out of our flesh. In the book of Ephesians, in chapter 4, verse 22 to 24, Paul describes it like this. He said, we have to take off the old man and be clothed in the righteousness of Christ. Put on the new man, which is after Christ. You can also find a similar passage in Colossians chapter 3, verses 9 and 10. We have to obey at any cost in this process. You know, as I read to you, I believe some this morning, not this morning, it was mostly Friday night, we talked about obedience and how Jesus said, that's a sign of our love for him. It's a sign of our identification with him too. Because we're saying, I don't want the things of the world, I want the things of Christ. So it's obedience and forsaking. Remember, this is one other thing you're going to see in Romans 6. We're a love slave. We're that living sacrifice. But Romans 6 says, as we yield and give ourselves fully to God, he takes this body and makes it an instrument of righteousness. And isn't that true? Sometimes you find yourself in just the right place, at just the right time, and God starts to use you. And you think, I can't believe this. I can't believe it. I remember once, this is the honest about truth, my husband and I were invited by one of the U.S. senators, Senator Inhofe. We had gone to Capitol Hill to kind of advocate for the night commuter children in northern Uganda when we were working up there. And so he came over to Uganda, and while he was there, we got invited to breakfast with the president of Uganda. I'm like nobody. And I'm in a small group of people. The US ambassador to Uganda was there, Senator Inhofe, and a couple of folks from his office, the Minister of Finance, and forgot the other minister's name, and my husband and I, we were the only ones there, and the wife, the president's wife, the first lady. And so we're sitting there, and his wife is openly a Christian, and she loves Jesus. She's worked like a lot on the idea of abstinence as a solution, as the solution for AIDS, and she's been commended globally for the work that she's done. She really does love the Lord. And so all of a sudden, the president himself says to Senator Inhofe, well, you know, my wife is one of those born-again Christians, and she believes that only people who love Jesus are going to heaven. And he turns and he looks at the U.S. ambassador, who was Jewish, and says to him, you know, and she believes the Jews crucified him. How do you feel about that? And the poor ambassador is like, oh that crucified Jesus, it was me. And I had like just a couple minutes to say something about Jesus to someone that I would normally never get to see. And it opened the door that my husband got to share, and he became interested in what we were saying. And my husband had like maybe 5 or 10 minutes while everyone was in the room, and he was talking about how he could prove that Jesus was the truth. And he used a funny, simple example about how, you know, Buddha said this is the way and pointed in all these different ways. And I may have these, some of them wrong. One of Confucius, I think it was, said, I'm searching for the way. I forgot what Muhammad says, but he had all these funny hand signals while he was saying each one true, though. And then he said, but Jesus said, I am the way. I know the way. He's the only one with an empty tomb. And the president, you could tell, just stepped from that place of making what he thought was light, funny conversation to being drawn. And after that breakfast, we were invited to have a private meeting with him, which we were supposed to have a meeting anyways, to talk about our work in northern Uganda. And for 45 minutes straight, my husband got to preach the gospel to him. 3 times he got to ask him to receive Jesus Christ. How did God use me? How did God use my husband? Because we just yielded. We just yielded. And in that moment, we became partakers of the divine nature of God. And we were instruments in his hands. And you will be too. You never know where God's going to take you. You never know what he's going to do. That's just a really fun example to share. Okay. We must go in and give ourselves to be wholly possessed of Christ. So this is all that first step. We come out, denying ourselves, reckoning ourselves dead, all the things you're going to learn in Romans chapter 5, 6, and 7. And then we go out, which you're going to see a little bit in 7 and the rest of 8 of Romans. See what it's like to, as I said this morning, live and move and have your being in Christ. Acts 17, 28. Think about Galatians 2, 20. I've been crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. You know, it's not me, but Jesus is alive in me. And there's so many wonderful scriptures about that. You'll learn more about the indwelling, the abiding, as I shared with you the testimony of Hudson Taylor. Can you see how these things are all starting to come together? When you look at how the scripture, over and over again, I'm like, how did I miss this? How did I miss this is how you enter into rest? It's on almost every page. The second thing I see in the scripture, which is over and over again brought up in the book of Hebrews, is that we're to hold fast. We just read it. To our confidence, to our testimony, to our Savior. And again, this is something that starts all the way back in Deuteronomy. We're supposed to cling to him. Actually, I believe it's Deuteronomy 8:20. It's either 8:20 or 30:20. I don't remember exactly which, but it says, you should hold fast to your God. You should cling to him. You should cleave unto him because he's your life. Isn't that just the same thing as what we're reading right here? So all the way back in Deuteronomy, that same message was being given. It's our confidence. It's our hope. It's our assurance. It's our promise. It's my engagement ring from Jesus. It's the Holy Spirit in me. Hang on to it. I'm so grateful that it's not just up to me, because I don't know about you, but when I went through menopause, I just completely lost my memory. I really, really did. Emily can tell you, I used to have a great memory. And mine was not gradual, because I had surgery. So some of you went through it slow. Nuh-uh. Mine was tomorrow. It's just gone. I lose things. I misplace things. I have every intention of something, and I'm not able to make it because my memory fades. Not going to happen with the Holy Spirit. He's in me. He's sealed me. He was sent as a keeper, not like a guard in a prison, but like a protector, like a lover to say, even if you're faithless, Vicky, I'm going to be faithful. Read Ephesians chapter 1, verses 13 and 14. About his promise and his down payment to us. Hold fast. I want to give give you a couple scriptures that we're not going to go through and read, but just write them down and try to read them a little bit later if you can, tonight or tomorrow. Chapter 3, verse 6 and verse 14. Also in Hebrews, chapter 4, verse 14. And then in Hebrews, chapter 10, verse 23. And this is one I want us to read together. Turn with me, if you would, to Revelation, chapter 2. Because this is the words of Jesus. He's speaking to the church in Thyatira, and he says in verse 25 of chapter 2, "But hold fast what you have until I come for you." Hold fast. Even Jesus is exhorting us to hold on to it. He says, I believe it's in the Gospel of Luke, he says, "In patience possess your soul unto the end." In the midst of that difficulty and that hardship, possess your soul. Hold on to it. Don't lose your faith. Don't lose this agape love that I've given you. I'll keep on giving it. And if you lost it, then tell the truth. I don't know where I put it. Yes, I was careless. God, help me. Please, can you give me some more? He's never going to say no. He's never going to say no. Hold fast. Next, I would say, don't try to ever separate going out from your place of bondage and going into your place of promise or the destiny or the place God has ordained for you. And here's what I mean. We all know the story very well of the thief on the cross. He says to Jesus, "Lord, please remember me." He rebukes his friend. Hey, we're making fun of this guy. We're guilty. He's not. That's not right. We shouldn't be making fun of him. Remember me, Lord. And what does Jesus say then? Today you will be with me in paradise. His journey was really short. It was really short. He just went out from the cross right into heaven. And I think that many people believe that's how everybody's journey is. They're really, really happy to be delivered from the penalty of their sin. The idea that I get to go to heaven and all my sins are paid for, that's awesome. But this sanctification and holiness and serving, I'm not really interested. Be careful. Be careful. Because what is expressed in how we live is Jesus' own words were that it's a direct reflection of what's in our heart. And if Jesus is alive and in our heart, if his character and nature is not starting to be birthed in us, somehow we've tried to separate the two. Listen with me, if you would, for a second to what Andrew Murray says about that right here. Sorry, I made these neat little markers so I wouldn't take forever, so hopefully I won't. Okay. He says this. "It is to be feared that there are many Christians who try to divide what God has joined together. They would gladly be brought out from the land of bondage. However, they are not ready to go all the length with God, to enter the land and to conquer every new enemy. They would gladly be made happy in being delivered from bondage. They long not to be made holy in a life of separation and service, though. They do not listen to the voice that calls them to enter God's rest, but they harden their hearts instead." And listen to this. "Realize that it was not in Egypt. It was on the very border of Canaan, the very border of the promised land, that the men of God had begun to harden their hearts. It is among Christians who profess that they've been converted, who have not only begun in the Christian life, but have even made some progress in it, that the hardening of the heart may still be found. The call to holiness, the call to cease from the life of wandering and complaining and enter into the rest of God, the call to the life of victory over every enemy, sorry, and to the service of God in the land of the promise, these are the ones they don't want to obey. They say it's too high, the cost, it's too hard. They don't believe with Caleb that we're able to possess this land. Instead, they fear sacrifice and they cling to the carnal life. And what did Jesus say in John 3:18? He says, they love darkness more than light. They love their sin more than they love me. You know, we have a friend whose son he was raised in a Christian home, and just two so godly, the parents, they just loved Jesus so much, and he unfortunately became addicted to heroin. And many of you have children who've gone through similar things, or you know someone who has, and this last time, for the last 7 years, they've been really bad, and he's been in and out of different rehabs. He's had some other health problems, and his life has just been on the edge. It's just God's grace, his life. The dad was driving him, and the father told me with tears in his eyes, he said, he just looked at me and he said, Dad, I love these drugs more than I love you, more than I love mom, more than I love my own son. You know, it's so hard for us to understand that, but people do love sin like that. And boy, you know, whatever we feed is what's going to grow, like we saw the other day. If we're feeding our carnal life, it's a really dangerous place to be. It's precarious. There's something else I wanted you to glean out of here, though. They fear sacrifice and they cling to the carnal life. It's not listening to God's voice. Their hearts are hardened. And God has said to them, you can't enter my rest. I cannot too much stress with every earnest urge that you Christian readers learn about these two stages of the Christian life. There are the carnal and there are the spiritual. There are those who remain babies and those who are full grown. There are those who come up out of Egypt but then remain in the wilderness of a worldly life. And there are those who follow the Lord fully, entering the life of rest and victory. Each one of us needs to look where we're standing and take earnest heed to God's warnings. With our whole hearts, let's press in and go all the length in following Jesus and in seeking to stand perfect and complete in the will of God. I just think that's such a true statement for today. Would you agree? Is that not what we're looking at? We need to not set those two things apart. We need to fight for fruit. Jesus said, my desire, my Father's desire is that every tree bears fruit. And my heart for you is that you bear much fruit. God's not trying to have skimpy little, maybe once in a while your gifts will make a difference. No. It says he went into cities and touched people and counseled and helped. And that's what happens when you come to your ladies' Bible study every week or when you're in church every Sunday. Because your pastor and the team that you have working with you guys, they love the Lord. They're partaking of the divine nature. They've gone the extra step. They've said no to the carnal life, and that's why you see fruit. You're getting fed. Let that be in you. And you know, encourage yourself. Be, as I said the other day, intentional. Yeah, I don't want to get sidetracked. All right. Next, we have to remember, so far we've said, we come out of self, we come out of the bondage and go into the promise. The second thing is we hold fast to our confidence. Number three, the first thing is, I'm so sorry guys, we take off the old and put on the new. We have to be born again and we have to be intentional. Then we hold fast, we don't separate the going out and coming in. Fourthly, it's a battle. And we have to be diligent, and we are going to talk a lot about that tomorrow, so let me skip over it right now. And then I want to say today, as we have a couple other things that I want to explain, but these are just a few things I came up with, okay? This is not an exhaustive list. We need to yearn for God and cease from our works. And this is one of my favorite parts about this scripture here, and that's what I want to move into. Those, I literally just sat down and in a few minutes said, well, what do I need to do if I want to be a partaker? There are thousands of other small steps I can take. There are thousands of other ways, because God's desire is for us to be prolific. He doesn't make it difficult for us to find ways to partake. We can pray. I could stand here and talk about this all night long, but that's not what you need. So ask the Lord to show you, Lord, for me and my schedule with what I've got going on, show me where I can start partaking of you. Show me where I should start asking. And it's okay to be bold. It's okay. It's not selfish. It's not ordering God around. This is what God says, yes. I'm so excited they're asking for that. It'd be like your kids saying, can you show me where the broccoli is? You know? They're not asking for the potato chips and the ice cream. You know? You get excited about it. That's how the Lord feels when we're asking these questions. Okay, so I want us to look in Hebrews, and I want to show you this because it's one of my favorite things, as I just told you. But of course, now I have lost my place. You have to just look in my Bible. Let's see. Sorry. Yep, here it is. Okay. In chapter 4, we're going to look at verse 9 and 10. There remains, therefore, a rest for the people of God, it says in 4, verse 9. And then 10 says this: the one who has entered into God's rest has also ceased from his works as God did from his. And this always confused me. For a very long time, I would read over it and think, I don't get what that means. So I'm going to do my best to utilize what Andrew Murray explains, because I think he does a really good job of making it something we can sink our teeth into. Basically, what he's saying is we move to the place of maturity where we understand, as we would learn in Romans, as we have talked about partaking, where it's not us, it's not our righteousness, it's not our merit, it's Christ that's giving us this gain, this entrance. And we are, by resting, he's meaning we're secure. We're secure and we're walking up to the door. We have the badge of identification that shows I am part of this family, and the gate's wide open for us to enter into this place of rest. This is the broad place. This is where the shepherd is taking the pasture or the herd to pasture. It's the place that's protected. It's the place that we find all of the supplies that are needed for all of the missions that we go out on. It's the place where we come to be refilled by God. It's all that God has. You know how we talked about this morning for just a minute, Philippians 4, that he might supply all of our needs according to his riches and glory. This is where they're stored. It's not a physical place, but you understand what I'm saying. It's in Christ. And we are saying that we're going to cease from striving and trying to get to maturity by ourselves. Instead, we're going to take that badge of identification with Christ, and we're going to show it. And surprise of all surprises, the door's going to open. And we're going to start to be able to partake and come in and go out. And we're going to hear him call our name. And we're going to see that he's going to send us for an important mission that you would think, I don't know, maybe a bishop goes for. Or, you know, the head of a ministry for the last 10 years. No, he's going to send us. Because we're equipped for it, and he knows everything we have. I just think that is such a precious part, and I want to save that, a little bit of that topic for tomorrow, because it's so precious. And I want to, what time is it? How much time do I have left? Like 5-10 minutes? Okay, so is it okay with you guys too? I know that's an important topic, but we'll finish up tomorrow, because I know we want to have more worship and stuff. So this is what I want to, in these last few minutes, close up with. I had the opportunity to teach on Song of Solomon at a church a few years ago, and while I was praying today of how to wrap up tonight and and just trying to bottle some of that excitement so that I could clearly articulate to you what I felt the Lord was showing me. I was reminded of this, so I just want to share this with you, and I think a lot of you are going to identify, and maybe as you start to hear the words and the names of the biblical examples I'm going to give you, think, I already know all that. Would you just do me a favor and listen afresh? Because I know this came from the Lord, and I know that it's so simple, but it's so true. I want you to think for just a minute about that passage of scripture we're all so familiar with from 1 Corinthians, about how God chooses the weak things and the foolish things, and you know how that makes us, well, it makes me so happy. There's other people that maybe get offended, but I'm excited about that. But you know, I see like he's picked people like Elisha that are farmers, Esther who was an orphan, Mary Magdalene who was demon possessed, and some people think maybe she was a prostitute, and you know, tent makers, and I see him just using normal people and weak people, and that excites me. But I want to take you just one step further in that process. I want you to think about Moses, who's considered one of the greatest men of God. Always he's associated with the law, and he's so important. He's mentioned over and over again. But remember when God called him, he said, I can't go, God, I stutter. God, you can't send me back to Egypt. He was afraid. I want you to think about Gideon. He was so afraid when the Lord appeared to him, or the angel of the Lord appeared to him. He said, you can't be talking to me, God. Look, it's nighttime. I'm threshing my wheat at night. I'm so scared of the Midianites. This can't be. And he calls him a mighty man of valor. And it takes Gideon several miracles of God to really believe that it's true, that God's calling him. Think about Jeremiah, the weeping prophet, who we look at now and we esteem so much because he's compared to Jesus in the New Testament. He endured so many incredible persecutions. You know, he came and said, I'm just too young, God. I'm just a boy. Nobody's going to respect me. No one's going to... Okay, not everyone. The majority of the people in the scriptures that we exalt and revere, they were afraid. They had excuses of why God had the wrong person. And as the Lord gave this to me, I just want to say to us as ladies, if I were to ask you right now, okay, could you please come and lead this Bible study group? You guys are going to go down to this center. You're going to go here. You'd be all like, whoa, whoa. I don't have that gift. She has it. You can tell me who else in your group has that gift. Is that not true? But, and then if we were just seated here, just us, and these guys in the sound weren't listening, and we were, I said, okay, ladies, we're going to go around and we're going to talk about what our spiritual gifts are. We'd be like, who's going to go first? You know? And then we'd try, like, well, it's Emily's turn. Well, I can tell you what Emily's gift is. She's my best friend. She has a gift of encouragement. She has a gift of mercy. And I would go on the list. I could tell you all of her gifts. But to tell you mine would be really hard. And I don't know why we are so hard on ourselves. Very few women can receive a compliment. If my husband says, oh, you look beautiful. And you know, you can tell by his voice when he really means it. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, when it's not just he's saying it because I had a rough day, or you know, but like he just really means it, and you think, don't say that. I am not. Can't you see? Right? We do that. It is so hard for us to see any potential in ourselves, especially as women. We have got to change that. And I want you to just think with me for a couple more seconds before we close. I told you about those three guys. Now I want you to think about David. David, who his own dad didn't want to bring him before the prophet. When he was told specifically one of his sons, Jesse's like, that's all the sons I got. I mean, that's so sad, you know? I would be devastated if my dad was like, yeah, that's all the kids I got, but what about me? You know, I was born in this house. But he's left outside, he's a shepherd, he's the youngest one, he He wasn't dressed fancy. He probably didn't go to school. He was given just this menial job. He liked to play his harp and do all this stuff that was maybe not common for boys in his profession. He loved to sing and write poetry, but nobody could understand his poetry because you can't discern the things of the Spirit unless you have the Spirit in you, unless you're a spiritually minded person. But here he was, David, chosen, called. He didn't make any excuses. He just stood there and he poured the oil. Then he goes to the front lines. And he hears Goliath talk against God. The whole army's there. Decorated veterans, I'm sure. And they're just quaking in fear of Goliath. And he goes. And with one stone, because he goes in the name of God, he's victorious, right? He wins so many accolades through his life. But you will see that pattern over and over again in David. He never looked at himself. He never looked at himself. And that is where so many of us fall. And I want you to know that we have that same choice tonight. And I promise, this is where I'm going to close. I really feel like walking around, so I got to stand right here or you won't be able to hear me. There is two choices before you tonight. You can say that I can't. You can say I don't want to. You can say this is something I'll make a commitment that I'm going to start to do, but I know myself. My resolutions last 5 minutes. You can say I could never be as bold as so-and-so. I could never share my faith like that. I'm just shy. I'm not white. You can make a million excuses. Because the Lord is calling you. I suspect that some of you today in your quiet time, he even spoke to you then about something he has for you. And you were like, nah, that can't be. He must have meant someone else. Or you can be David. That choice is before you. We are given the opportunity for an exchange. An absolute exchange. It has zero to do with you and me. It has everything to do with Jesus. Everything. You are able because he is able. You are the one he's chosen. I want you to write down Philippians chapter 1, verse 20 and 21. And Colossians chapter 1, verse 27. I have so many other verses I want to give you, but I just want to leave you with that thought tonight. Because there is a whole world out there that needs to be saved. And ministry is not just Sunday school and teaching Bible study and, you know, working in the tape ministry or doing sound. Those are all ministry. I'm not saying they're not, but that's not all ministry is. Ministry is how you guys, some of you, you love to quilt. That's a ministry. It's your opportunity to invite someone who doesn't know Jesus. And while you're sitting there exchanging ideas and sharing techniques and patterns, you can start to tell them about Jesus. You can invite them to make a quilt for someone who's in the hospice. Or you yourself can make a quilt that's going to go to someone who's dying. And you can go and deliver it yourself. Or if you're shy, you can send someone in your team that has the heart to evangelize. And in Jesus' name, you can pray over every stitch. It's the reason you love to bake. It's why you have unlimited texting on your phone. Honestly, you know, how many times does God put someone on your heart just in the middle of the day? I've told this story probably before. I don't think I've ever told it to you guys, but years ago, I was in the middle of a terrible crisis. I was terrified. I do not easily get scared. We were embroiled in a custody battle for my kids, my brother's youngest ones, and the social services people had been riding on us and down our necks, and it was just terrible. And I was so scared, and I kept trying to leave the house. I was just trying to do anything to distract my mind so the kids wouldn't realize how scared I was. And my phone rang, and this young gal from my Bible study that I went to on Tuesday night said, "Hi." And she told me her name, and she goes, "I'm supposed to read you this psalm." She read me Psalm 91. To this day, every time I read that psalm, I think of Linda and I think of that phone call. I just started weeping because I knew it wasn't her, it was Jesus. You have unlimited texting for a reason. You love to bake so you can give real homemade cookies to that kid that you see loitering around who looks like trouble and you hope your daughter never looks at him. You know? You can start telling him about Jesus now. All of those things are ministry. You don't have to be someone else. Be you. Just be available. And I hope tonight as we have these songs, and I know Cindy's going to close for us, that you'll just surrender that part of your understanding to him and say, God, if this is true, I saw it in David. Maybe there's some other people in the Bible. I got to check that out. But if what she's saying is true, I'm in. Because we need you. We need a whole army of women to win this world for Jesus. Heaven's not full yet. Let's pray. God, I thank you so much for your exceedingly great and precious promises. I thank you so much that you use broken sinners like us, God. I thank you that you don't turn anyone away. And I thank you for the way that you've uniquely and fearfully and wonderfully made each one of us, God. And I just pray for these women, Lord, that they would feel your anointing come upon them afresh tonight, God. I know your spirit lives in them. I know they're saved, God, but I just pray that hope would rise up afresh in them. I pray that your grace would just be poured out in such a way, and your giftings, God, that each one of them would walk out of this building with an excitement and a fire to be part of proclaiming your great word to this world. Lord, I just ask that you give wisdom to Cindy as she closes us. Lord, I pray for this time of worship. I just thank you so much for these girls, Lord. I know everyone in this room would echo that. Every single song has just felt like it took our heart closer to you, God. And we thank you so much for that gift you've given them. Lord, if there's some way we can pray for them tonight and just bless them in return and say thank you, God, we want to do that. Reward them, Father, please. We have been so blessed by you this weekend, Lord. And we're just so excited for communion tomorrow. And we're just so excited for what you're going to do tonight as we close and as we have fellowship in our rooms. We just praise you and love you. And